Mr. Hiranandani, thank you very much for joining in this conversation. So let me start by asking you that one question. You know, your father is a renowned ENT doctor and you decided to get into business. How did that happen?
Long story. The long and short of it is my elder brother was a doctor and he was 10 years older to me. And I was petrified that I had to study so hard to do medicine. Commerce was an easier career and I did that. But at the end of it, my father and Mr. Nani Palkhiwala conned in to make me a chartered accountant, see, which I did. But I was quite perseverant. I wanted to get into the business of business and I did.
There must have been some challenging times, sometimes where you actually wondered whether it was worth doing that business. Did you actually encounter such moments?
Challenges? Every day. You get up in the morning and if you don't get a challenge, it means tomorrow you're doomed. And you're going to get such a big challenge that you won't be able to miss it. So you better get your challenge this morning and finish with it. So I think we've run a course with great amount of violence, difficulties, problems, and of course looked down upon. You know, when I started in Mumbai, only the Haji Mastan and the Dawoods and those kind of stories were people who did real estate and black market was flourishing. So I think it was a big challenge in order to do it. I remember one time we tried to create an organization of builders and we tried to fix a meeting with a minister and he said that, you know, so the PA was told by the minister that yes, put Niranjan Hiranandani's name, but not in the diary.
My goodness.
Because he felt that, you know, being with a builder in an official meeting may not look good. And as compared to this, in the next 15, 20 years, I became advisor to Government of India. I joined HUDCO board. I was on committees for slum rehabilitation. I drafted the housing policy for the Government of India. Worked towards scrapping of a ULC.
Has the change in real estate, because you know, you've been in industry phase, you've been lobbying for the industry with the government at every opportunity that you're presented. Has it been too slow according to you, or do you think that, look, this is the way in India, in a democracy, it works and we just have to go along with it?
You know, when 1991 came and perestroika happened, I thought the change would be immediate and inevitable. It happened in airlines, it happened in automobiles, it happened in telecom, it happened in industry, it happened in cement, it happened in every possible business. It didn't happen in real estate at all. It took ages to scrap urban land ceiling. Somehow or the other, we have failed. Industry has totally failed. Look at the situation in Mumbai. The richest city in the country. Everybody gets a job at the end of the day or at least two meals to do. 50% plus people live in Jhopatpattis in Mumbai. What a sad situation. Half the people living in the Jhopatpatti can actually afford the house they live in. Provided you make small houses and provided they get title to the property, they would actually be able to afford. And the price for which they are having that house, you could get a regular house on which they could get loan, they would get titles, they would get inheritance, and there would be wealth creation. But we have failed them.
Let's come back to a slightly brighter picture in terms of what you built. First integrated township, which became an absolutely a benchmark in the way Mumbaikars started living a life which was extremely of high quality. How did you chance upon that idea?
Actually, it was out of frustration that I went to Powai. I built lots of buildings before that. The 11 buildings in Lokhandwala complex in Warsawa. We did buildings in Mulund, in Malad, in Parle, various places. And when I completed each of these buildings and looked out of the window, I felt so sad. Not because the buildings were not good in which I had built it, but when I looked out of the window, everything looked so horrible. The roads, the street lights, the sewerage, the stormwater drains, the gardens around the places which I was doing, totally inadequate and incomplete, made you feel so unhappy. And because of my father, I lived in Malabar Hill. I was brought up there with all the luxuries of hanging gardens in Kamala Nehru Park and good schools and good hospitals and stuff like that. So I wanted to make something which ultimately would make me happy, which is make a project which was better than Malabar Hill. And that was the objective that I think I started on. And if I looked out of the window of any of the buildings that I completed, I would be as happy as I would be in the best building in Mumbai. So I think that was the ambition. Went to Powai because I didn't have enough money. And at that time, Powai was very, very far and relatively cheap lands that I could possibly get at those time. And of course, we went on to make them better layouts, better infrastructure, good gardens, schools, hospitals, and so on and so forth. And we succeeded.
Look around you and give me a sense in terms of which are the markets. We do know that Mumbai is facing one of its MMR, including Thane, is facing one of its most sluggish period that it's seen, probably worse than what we actually saw after 2009. And the recovery then was very quick, very fast. This time around, do you think it's more prolonged?
Obviously, it is. There is no question about it. We've already had a recessionary year, and I think one more year you're likely to see a recessionary situation as far as MMR is concerned.
Let's move on to India versus, and this is a question I asked Darshan as well when he featured on Young Guns, why did you go to Dubai? So my question to you is, why did you send Darshan to Dubai?
Well, I like to think that I was instrumental in persuading him to go, but let me tell you some secret. He came back from the United States doing his MBA and wonderfully did it and came here and told me every day what I was doing wrong.
He was telling you what you were doing wrong.
Yeah.
And that was very irritating.
Very irritating. I love him too much, but he was irritating. Nevertheless, so then we went and visited Dubai and we'd gone for a kind of a holiday to Egypt. And on the way back, we stopped there. And I really looked around the markets and I found it exciting. And I told him, I said, why don't you look at Dubai? And I made the biggest blunder of all because he grabbed it. You know, he grabbed that opportunity to set up independent operations. He built a beautiful building in the worst recessions of the UAE markets. Worst recession, I would say. Completed the second tallest residential tower in the world beautifully, 23 Marina, and did an excellent job. But I miss him, you know, hugely, because I'm not able to persuade him to totally come back to India. And he says, hey, look at India, look at the mess that you are in terms of how the government and other people treat you after 30 years of great work. You want me to come to do that? And you know, I'm in a dilemma because I can't tell him, come nevertheless and all that. And you know, and he's got a lovely, and he's got a lovely daughter, Zoya. And of course I would prefer Zoya to be living here rather than shifting up and down from Dubai. So. That's the second reason to want him back quickly.
Absolutely. See, already the granddaughter has you wrapped around her little finger. So so that's Darshan. And I believe Surinder's daughter has also joined the business.
Neha has also joined the business. And she looks after two of the things in Bangalore and in Chennai. And she's doing a wonderful job too. Hmm. We're a very bright next generation.
Between you and Surinder, I mean, he joined the business. He's your younger brother later. Were there any points of conflict or there was huge or no?
Oh, we fight every day.
Oh, you fight every day. Okay, I'm so glad to hear that because I've just concluded an interview where two brothers have said that they've never fought.
No, we fight every day and we have lunch together every day. So on the days we are in office together, we always eat together. So we have lunch in the same room. We have great differences of opinion. And I think about in the 30 years, we've had headlines in at least 30 newspapers, including the front page of Times of India, where I was told that my brother and I were separating. And I picked up the phone and asked him in those days, which is about 20 years ago, that are we separating? So he says, who told you this? I said, the newspaper. Mm-hmm. So he said, ha, you know, that kind of thing. So, I mean, of course, we have restructured our businesses in the sense we have what is called the yours, mine, and others' businesses.
What happened with Priya? Why did things come to such a level where, you know, it's after all, it's a daughter.
I think it's the distance. Hmm. She migrated to the US. She set up a BPO, very successful, made a lot of money. She sold that for, in those days, fantastic amount of money. She made $100 million. And then we tried to work together. And the distance, I think, kept a huge amount of differences between the thought processes of the siblings as well as me. And obviously that ultimately ramped up with a recession in 2009 to lead up with great misunderstanding. Mm-hmm. And she's a very strong girl and very clever, intelligent, but very strong. And she had strong feelings that she was hurt. Mm-hmm. And you know, a woman scorned.
Really? But it must hurt you too. I mean,
of course it hurts me. Of course, any father would hate not to be loved by the daughter. But at the end of the day, I think we will be able to sort it out. We have worked out through an arbitration route, and probably the entire thing by next year end would get completed. It's a lot of assets and stuff like that, so it should get over by next year. And I think they will put that behind us.
But what is your position on Hirco today? I mean, this
Hirco, you must know that in 2010, I was asked to resign from Hirco, which I did. And after that, there was a proposal of merger of the development company with Hirco, which was rejected by the then shareholders of Hirco. And we tried to find out via media, because there was a recession in 2009 and 10, because the projects would not be moving at this pace and pace and would not give the kind of returns which the Hirco shareholders were expecting and which was originally conceptualized. So we tried to find a method by which we could do it. But by that time, I was out of the company and I really couldn't do the operations of the company. And those operations of the company were professionalized and tried to work it through that route. It didn't work out, but today, for instance, the banks have foreclosed in the Panvel and Chennai project, and obviously we have to protect the buyers of those things, because there are more than 2,000 of them.
Absolutely.
So they have to be protected. Also, the banks have to be fully paid. The projects, fortunately, are worth much more than what the value which the banks have to be taken. So I think by another 3 to 4 months, all this should be put on track.
So let's move on to then what's next. I mean, this we will put behind us in 4 to 5 months, and then where do you go from here? What's the long-term vision?
I think there are a couple of things which I'd like to do. I don't know whether I can do it, but I'd love to do it. I do a little bit in education. I'd like to grow that. I'd like to work on policy again, because I think the policies have not fructified, and I think we need to make a paradigm in the policies that we are running. And all the policies presently are bullshit, because they don't produce the end result. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, what doesn't produce results should be thrown away, and we should really relook at everything that we are doing. So that's my first wish.
Mm.
The second wish I really have is to see that I can broad base my business activity more professionally and more so I can replicate what I'm doing in a much more structured way. I want to start community colleges, or what's called skill development centers. We plan to start one next year. So we're going to start next in January. I plan to start that. We're going to start with 300 students, and I plan to reach at least 30,000 students in the next 10 years, every year. So I'm trying to work on that. And that's another ambition that I have, which I have in my heart. I put it on paper to start the first college, and it will be active from the January of 2014. We will be starting it at Ulhasnagar.
Really?
So you will see it off the ground very quickly. So there are lots of ambitions in terms of my business creativity, in terms of social commitment. I still like to party, and it's a lot of fun,
not?
And I enjoy it.
Yes.
I love to meet people like you. Beautiful people like you.
So glad.
And also, I like to meet different sort of people, and intellectual people, and I love to mix with the young people.
So, a full life, absolutely, and many, many visions and goals and plans. Niranjan Hiranandani, thank you very much. One of the most interesting conversations that I've had.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I love it.